most of the time in the angular, in the rotational problems that you're going to have, you have something that happens in the plane, you have the turntable, so you have two vectors in plane. And so the angular momentum will be pointing perpendicular to the plane. You don't have to worry about that. You will have to explain that. I'm just telling you that by definition of the angular momentum, it's not in the same plane as our direction. Okay. But what you will worry about is just the magnitude of the vector. The magnitude L, you can write it both ways, is magnitude of R times magnitude of T times the sine of the angle between the two vectors. So it's the same definition as for torque. Okay. Maybe you didn't see that when we covered it with perpendicular, because maybe he didn't that is at distance R from the rotation axis. Okay. So if you imagine you have a rotation axis and then you have a rod perpendicular to it with one point particle of mass m rotating at constant distance r from this rotational axis. So r is the vector going from the rotation axis to the position of the point particle. Okay. And p in this case is a circle of motion. P would be tangential to the circle because it's collinear to the velocity. So in this particular situation, view from the top, you have this. The rotation axis delta would be here. The point particle would be and the velocity is 1. Like that. You would have R being this vector. And you would have just going to see how we're going to affect a sign depending on how the torque works. So R plus P in magnitude would be magnitude of R times magnitude of P times the sign of the angle between the two vectors. And since they're perpendicular to each other, the sign is 1. theta is defined to 3 in this case. So that would be only r times p in magnitude. Okay? Finding this part? So that's for point particle. Now we have a macroscopic object in rotation about an axis that has rotational inertia I. And if the object has enough symmetry, so we can be a cylinder or a sphere or a cone, you see every time it has a symmetry axis, then we can use for L the analog as we had for P equals MV. You can say, okay, the analog of M is I and the analog of V is P. So L would be I omega. It's not completely true every time. It's going to be true for you all the time for all the examples you're going to have to cover. Okay. But if you don't have enough symmetry, if it's a weird object, and you don't have symmetry axis, that would not be true. So we have axis delta, this vertical, and you have the turntable that's horizontal, actually, so it's perpendicular to the rotation axis. It has a certain radius r that we don't know, so you see that we don't need it. We just know that the turntable itself, without anything on it, has rotational inertia I, and initially an angular speed omega. Then you throw the water clay on the turntable with an initial velocity v that's tangential to the turntable. So it means it's not pointing at a weird angle like this. You're going to throw it like this, which is the same direction as the linear velocity of this one, for example. Okay? You were to draw the linear velocity of the direction of bonding between particles making the object, then this force here is actually corresponding to the external forces. This is also not true all the time. It's going to be true for you all the time. You can consider that this force here is just the sum of all the force of the external forces acting on the system. So I write both with a vector arrow, but you're going to use that only with the magnitude of the vector. Okay. So just L like this, that's the magnitude of the angular momentum equals I omega. And GLDC, so that's the rate of change.
And remember guys, it's not a PC. It's a tablet with a keyboard. ASUS.